We're glad you've joined us on Songs of Praise, an hour of musical reflection to encourage your heart.
She's hiding wings, 'cause sometimes Coming home. Let tents of ease be left behind, and onward to the fray. Salvation's helmet on each head, with truth all girt about. The earth shall tremble 'neath our tread, and echo with a shout. Faith is the victory, faith is the victory. Oh, glorious victory that overcomes the world. To him that overcomes the foe, white raiment shall be given. Before the angels he shall know his name confessed in heaven. Then onward from the hills of light, our hearts with love aflame. We'll vanquish all the hosts of night in Jesus' conquering name. Faith is the victory, faith is the victory. Oh, glorious victory that overcomes the world.
We hope you're enjoying Songs of Praise. Here's some more inspirational music. Thank you.
this whole world, give me Jesus. When I am alone, oh, and when I am alone, and when I am alone, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Give me Jesus.
Does Jesus care when my heart is pained too deeply for mirth and song? As the burdens press and the cares distress and the way grows weary and long. Oh, yes, He cares. I know He cares. His heart is touched with my grief. When I've said goodbye to the dearest on earth to me, and my sad heart aches till it is it aught to Him? Does He see? Oh, yeah. touched with my grief. When the days are weary, the long night dreary, I know, I know, I know, my in a dream I was there when they crucified Jesus. And in my dream I saw his great agony. And I ran to the man that was piercing his body. When I pulled him away, that soldier was me. Though only a dream, I crucified Jesus. And 'twas my sins he bore,
'twas my sins he bore
on Calvary's tree. Simon Peter was there, and his heart was so troubled, and many that Jesus had touched by the way, they beheld their Lord, their bleeding and dying. In the dream I could see that soldier was me. Though only a dream, I crucified Jesus. And 'twas my sins he bore,
'twas my sins he bore
on Calvary's tree.
Songs of Praise continues with more inspirational music.
I have heard of a land on the far away strand. 'Tis a beautiful home of the soul, built by Jesus on high, where we never shall die. 'Tis a land where we never grow old, never grow old,
where we'll never grow old,
in a land where we'll never grow old, never grow old,
where we'll
beautiful home, where we'll never more roam. We shall be in the sweet by and by. Happy praise to the King, through eternity sing. 'Tis a land where we never shall die, never grow old. We'll never grow old in a land where we'll never grow old, never. Troubles and trials are o'er. All our sorrow will end, and our voices will blend with the loved ones who've gone on before. Never grow
to just sit by. told of a man with two sons, written a long time ago. Now the younger one wanted a life of his own. He was tired of living at home. So he went to his father and asked him to give the portion that was rightfully his. He said, "Father, I must try to make it alone. I'm certain I know how to live." Now the kind-hearted father, he loved his dear son, but he didn't know just what to do. Should he grant the request of this impetuous one, or just try to talk these things through? When he gave him the portion he'd asked him to give, he said, "I'll be praying for you. Just heed my advice and be wise in your ways, for the world they will take it from you." If he would heed that warning, life would be better, I know. Sometimes it takes a struggle before we learn the way to go. Now the time had gone by and his journey had led to a place that was so far from home. Soon the money was spent and the friends were all gone, and he was left standing alone. And he thought about home and the servants he knew, how they always had plenty to spare. "Yes, I will return and confess to my father and ask him to dwell with them there. But when he came back home, his father was waiting for him. With open arms he embraced him. He said, 'My son has come home again.'" Said, "My son has come home again. What was lost now is found again." Are you just drifting away from your heavenly father's love? There is no reason to stray, just hold on to his arms of love.
His arms of love.
If you will heed this warning, life will be better, I know. There is no need to struggle before you learn the way to go. Before you learn the way to go. It's time we learn the way.
A city
You're listening to Songs of Praise. It's our desire to encourage and uplift your thoughts to our loving Creator God.
Who is on the Lord's side? Who will serve the King? Who will be His helpers? Other souls to bring. Who will leave the world side? Who will face the foe? Who is on the Lord's side? Who for Him will go? By Thy call of mercy, by Thy grace divine, we are on the Lord's side. Saviour, we are Thine.
Jesus, Thou hast taught us, not with gold or gem, but with Your
divine. We are on the Lord's side. 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 We are Thine. We are Thine. We are Thine. Fierce may be the conflict. Strong may foe, but the King's own army none can overthrow. Round the standard ranging, victory is secure. For His truth unchanging makes our triumph sure. Joyfully enlisting by Thy grace divine, we are on the Lord's side. Saviour, we rough. He is there to pick you up.
Calvary rages, I stand upon what never changes. If the sun were to fall, if the oceans were to dry, if the mountains were to crumble, I wouldn't bat an eye. I stand upon the rock. He's the rock of all the ages. No matter what may come, the storm around me rages. I stand upon what never changes. What never changes.
Join us again next time on Songs of Praise, brought to you by 3ABN Australia Radio, to enjoy more uplifting music.
Welcome to the book reading program of 3ABN Australia Radio. Does your faith need a boost? Do you think that miracles only happened in Bible times? Think again. Compiled by Remnant Publications, the book Get Ready for a Miracle recounts true stories that prove that when we step out in faith, God displays His power in undeniable ways. Here is our reader, Harold Harker.
This story is entitled Miracle of the Dead Trees. And Psalm 66 verse 19 says, "Certainly God has heard me. He has attended to the voice of my prayer." After I rededicated my life to the Lord, He called me into the publishing ministry. When we started Remnant Publications, I sold the businesses I was operating in partnership with my father, uncle and two brothers. My wife, Deb, and I used part of the money to launch Remnant Publications and part of it to live on. For the first 11 years, I never took a wage from Remnant because the ministry could not afford it. All we did was put money into Remnant. We were solely dependent on God. About that time, Deb and I moved our family to the wilderness of Montana, where we had the opportunity to really connect with God and each other. We had no debt, so we figured we could live on $13,000 per year. We had enough money to last us a while, but not indefinitely. I told my wife, who managed the finances, not to worry. I'll dig ditches by hand to earn money if I have to. One day, About 4 years after the move, Deb came to me and said, "You'd better buy that shovel." "Why?" I asked, thinking she was joking. "Because that's about how much money we have left, enough to buy a shovel," she replied, "and you need to start digging some ditches." "I have a better idea," I told her. "I'm going to see if those dead trees on our property are worth anything." When we had first moved to our 35-acre property, we had been told that the trees were no good for anything but firewood. But one of our employees at Remnant had recently called in a logger on their own land and had done quite well. "Maybe you should check into those dead trees," John, the employee, told me. "They're worth more now than they were a few years ago because the market is so good." So, after praying about our financial situation, I decided to call the same logger to see if we could get some money from the fallen timber on our property. The logger came out to see us. His name was Enos, and he was a dedicated Christian. "I think I can get 5 semi-trailer loads of wood from your dead trees," Enos told us. "I'll be happy to give you $3,750 up front." That meant $750 per load. "Well, what if you get more wood than that, I want to know? How much do you think is there?" Enos asked. "I was hoping for about 8 loads," I replied. Enos shook his head. Having been in this business for years, he had a pretty good idea how many loads to expect. "I'd be surprised if you get that much," he told us. "For one thing, part of your property is swampy ground and another part is a lake. So you'd do well if you have even 15 acres of woodland here. Remember, we're only taking the dead trees." "Yes," I replied. "But what will happen if you get more than you projected?" "I'll give you $750 per load," Enos promised. He estimated it would take his loggers about 1 week to remove the dead wood from our property. The loggers came as promised and worked on our property for a week. In the meantime, we were busy praying that they would find lots of dead trees. At the end of the week, I went out to check on their progress. "We're just about done," they told me. "Just a little bit more to do, so we'll be back on Monday morning to finish the job," they said. We kept praying. On Monday afternoon, when I went out to check on their progress, the loggers informed me that they'd found another stand of dead trees. "Seems like we missed one," they told me. "We'll be back to take that stand on Tuesday, and after that we'll be done." We kept praying. On Wednesday afternoon, when I went to check, they told me the same story. "Dwight, we just can't understand this," Enos said. "How many places can a dead tree hide? We just finished cutting over here, and then we find more dead trees over there, and on it goes." I went back to my house rejoicing that afternoon because I knew God was at work. There was no way they could find that many dead trees on our property, and yet they just kept finding them. It reminded Deb and me of the widow and her jar of oil, 2 Kings 4:1-7, or the widow whose barrel of meal was continually replenished during a terrible famine, 1 Kings 17:7-16. Enos and his men cut timber on our 15 wooded acres for a full 3 weeks. Every day they came expecting to finish the job, and every day they found more fallen timber. They finally did quit, but not because they'd run out of dead trees. Their other customers were getting upset because Enos was 2 weeks behind schedule. During those 3 weeks, I stood at the window and watched those loads going out with mounting excitement. By the time the loggers were done on our property, we did not have $3,750 for five loads as originally projected, but $13,500 worth of dead trees. That is 18 loads. That was a real miracle to get an entire year's income off dead trees and have our woods cleaned up at the same time. We have never forgotten how God provided for us. It was a real turning point in our lives because we realized that if God can make dead trees appear out of nowhere, He can do anything. A reflection on this story comes from Steps to Christ, page 98. By calm, simple faith, the soul holds communion with God and gathers to itself rays of divine light to strengthen and sustain it in the conflict with Satan. God is our tower of strength. Pray in your closet, and as you go about your daily labor, let your heart be often uplifted to God. It was thus that Enoch walked with God. These silent prayers rise like precious incense before the throne of grace. Satan cannot overcome him whose heart is thus stayed upon God. This story, Miracle of Dead Trees, was written by Dwight Hall, the founder and the CEO of Remnant Publications in Coldwater, Michigan. Remnant produces Christian books and resources for spiritual growth and evangelism. For more information, you can look at the website remnantpublications.com.
You've been listening to the book reading program by 3ABN Australia Radio, featuring Get Ready for a Miracle. For more information about this book, visit remnantpublications.com.
We hope you enjoy the short presentation from lineagejourney.com.
After Jesus died on the cross on Friday, on the sixth day of the week, the preparation day, the day prior to the Sabbath, he was taken to a tomb. Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus both went to see Pilate, and being men of means and influence, they were able to ensure that the body of Jesus was given an honorable burial rather than one that the lowest of criminals would receive. Luke 23, verse 50 to 56 points out that this day was the preparation day, the day prior to the Sabbath, and it was drawing near. As they didn't have time to prepare the body of Jesus fully, they went home with the intention to come back on the first day of the week. Even in death, Jesus rested on the Sabbath, showing the importance of the Sabbath to both Jesus and his followers. He was taken to what is known today as the Garden Tomb. This tomb here behind me, which was discovered in the late 1800s, is believed by many believers and scholars alike to be the place where Jesus rested. Soldiers were placed outside, and for a while it looked like they had finally gotten rid of Jesus. However, as the text says, "O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory?" Jesus was going to rest a while, but not forever. His supporters, though, were grief-stricken as their hopes for an earthly reign of Jesus were dashed. A large portion of the New Testament is focused on proving this key attribute of Jesus' divinity, that he rose from the dead. As the song says, we serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, no matter what men may say. When Jesus rose from the grave, it was marked, like his death, by an earthquake. The soldiers who were standing guard witnessed this momentous event. They saw the stone rolled. They saw the angels come down, and they saw Jesus come from the grave. Convicted in their hearts and with a story on their lips, they went to tell the priests, but they bribed them and convinced them to say that the disciples came and stole his body while they slept. There is no way that this truth could be suppressed, though. On Sunday morning, Mary was the first to come down here, and seeing the stone rolled away, she goes and tells the disciples that Jesus is not in the tomb. Peter and John then run to the tomb with her, and seeing that her account is accurate, they then leave. Mary, though, stays, and she lingers a while, stricken with grief. She then sees two angels who ask her why she is crying, and she says that they have taken Jesus' body and she cannot find it. It is then that Jesus appears to her and says, "Mary." She responds and says, "Rabbi," or "teacher," and he tells her to go and tell the others and Peter that he is risen. He specifically mentions Peter, for he knew how bad Peter felt since his denial, and he wants to let him know that he is forgiven. Filled with joy, Mary rushes to the disciples, this time bringing news of the resurrection. It was almost news that was too good to be true. Their hopes and dreams had been crushed at Calvary, and now, just a few days later, he is risen. The idea or concept of a resurrection is incredibly difficult to get one's mind around, but it was news that they wanted to believe. After all the miracles that Jesus had done, this was surely possible. Jesus is different to other gods, but it is on this point where the greatest distinction lies. Other gods that other faith groups venerate are either inanimate objects or they are dead. Jesus is different, for the grave had no hold over him. Death had no sting, and the grave had no victory. Our faith today has life because Jesus is risen. As he said to Peter before he denied him, "I'm going to prepare a place for you, and if I go, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also." Today we serve a risen Savior. He lives to make intercession for us, and he will one day come again and take us back to heaven. May we surrender our hearts to him. May we accept his gift of salvation and live with him for eternity.
For more episodes in the series, visit lineagejourney.com.
You've been listening to a production of 3ABN Australia Radio.